What about everyone? As you can see, it's not really space. That's the main issue in here. Main cause of that. Big old bomb bay fills up your entire aircraft. It runs down like that, all the way through, right down to the cockpit, you can see, all the way at the far end there. So you're basically building your aircraft around one massive bomb bay. So these big green lumps pushing through the middle here, those are the wing spars going through the center of the aircraft. By the time you get to number three, the main spar further down, you can see how high up that is. It's also around about that thick. So it's like climbing over a horse. It's very difficult to get around inside the aircraft quickly. So something bomber commands say is you're not allowed to fight on board Lancaster until you have proven to them you can get yourself from that cockpit over these wing spars, across this bomb bay, out the main hatch where you just came in 8 seconds. Which, when you are wearing big bulky flying gear and have a parachute stuck to your chest, so it's probably about that far away from your body, pretty hard to get done. Also, the most important thing I try to tell everyone when they get on board the aircraft, just how completely exposed the crew are inside. So what you're looking at around you is the actual skin of the plane. So there is no armor, there is no insulation, there is just 0.7 millimeters of aluminium alloy between you and the world outside. And that is about the same thickness and certainly worse quality material than the top of a Coke can. It's just not going to protect you from anything. Cold, I talked about, noise from the engines, it's just deafening in here at all times, and then bullets and shrapnel are just passing clean through the body of the aircraft. Only got 2 bits of armour on the aircraft. We've got an armour plate here on the upper turret. There's a second armour plate, it's about this big, it sits behind the pilot's head. Everyone else on board is unprotected. To make that worse for you, if you're on a British built Lancaster, rather than a Canadian built one, which what our one is, you don't get that armour plate either. The entire design is focused on one thing alone, get as much as you can in that bomb bay. And frivolities like crew protection are discarded at all points by the design team. The only focus is getting as much as you can down in there. Now, I am a pretty good rambler, as you've probably gathered, but I'd really rather talk about what you want to know about. So if you've got any questions, anything like asking what things are for, what life is like in here, just fire away
and ask it. Now, with a name like Minarski, you might think that Andy is a Pole. He's actually a second-generation Canadian Pole. And no sooner has the war begun, he does his duty, signs up to join the Canadian Army. Soon realises he has made a terrible mistake, and that marching for 25 miles a day is not what he wants to be doing. So he acquires a jar of Brill Cream, he styles his hair, and transfers over to join the Canadian Air Force. And during his air gunner training, he makes great friends with a man called Pat Brophy. And the two get along like a house on fire, always joking around, pranks, practical jokes, left, right, and center. Until one fateful day, Brophy gets himself promoted. Has the potential to throw a wrench into any relationship. But not one to be deterred or jealous, Minarski doubles down and makes fun of his friend every single chance he gets. And most famously, on their way back from the pub, every night, before they go their separate ways to their very different quality accommodation, Minarski throws his friend a massive mock salute and says, "Good night, sir," in the most patronizing, upbeat voice he can find. And it wasn't very funny the first time he did it. Go a couple hundred times down the road and imagine how Brophy has started feeling about the whole situation. Now, on the two men's final mission together, they are out bombing the German defences in the days after D-Day. And on the way out, the Lancaster is engaged by a German night fighter who scores hits on the inner wings, where the main fuel tanks are. The entire aircraft starts to fill up with fire, and the order is given to bail out. Minarski clambers down out of his mid-upper turret, makes his way to the rear hatch, and once he gets there, he looks down past it into the tail turret, where his friend Brophy is. The hydraulics in Brophy's turret have failed. And in his desperation to open up his turret by hand, Brophy has snapped off the hand crank in his fist. And he is now stuck inside this turret. Abandoning any thought of his own safety, Minarski grabs a fire axe at the side of the aircraft, crawls down, and starts battering away at the turret doors from the other side. But after several minutes' effort, the two men have only opened up a 6-inch or so wide gap in the sheet metal. And the flames are now caught up to them and are licking around Minarski's clothes. So, using his superior rank, Brophy orders Minarski to get out of the aircraft. An order Minarski promptly ignores. He stands there, batting away at the turret, trying to get his friend out. A minute or two more creep by. Brophy repeats the order. This time as a friend. He says, Andy, please, don't have much time left. Gotta get out of here while you still can. Leave me behind. And this time, Minarski listens to him. He presses him the fire axe through the hole in the door. He fights his way back through the flames. And once he gets to the rear hatch, he does what he does every night. He turns, he salutes his friend, says goodnight, sir, and he bails out the aircraft. Now at this point, both Minarski's clothes and his parachute are on fire. Nearby French villagers see him as he drops out of the sky and they rush to help him. But unfortunately, Minarski has died of his injuries by the sunrise. Brophy, somehow, incredibly, survives that crash. We are not really sure exactly what happened. Either bombs go off in the bomb bay, or the Lancaster hits a tall object, perhaps a tree. Something severs the tail clean off of the bomber. And this puts Brophy safely skidding across the fields of France, tucked away inside his gun turret. He is found by some French freedom fighters, nursed back to health, and he spends the rest of his war fighting with them. He does not find his way back to Britain until well into 45. And that's when he learns for the first time what happens to his best friend Minarski. At this point, Brophy declares it was divine intervention that saved him so he could tell the story of his friend's bravery. Minarski is awarded the posthumous Victoria Cross and is now one of the great Canadian war heroes. You can see his bust on the National War Memorial. Several Canadian RAF bases have statues of Minarski next to their front gates, often throwing his famous salute.
They clip onto an appropriate hatch attached to the bomber. So like, there's one on the top, there's a big one here. You clip your appropriate winch into place, and then you pull them up to get them. I say, I don't know why it's in here, rather than out there in the bombs.